This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book, The Great Boer War by Arthur Conan Doyle. Chapter 1, The Boer Nations. Take a community of Dutchmen of the type of those who defended themselves for 50 years, against all the power of Spain, at a time when Spain was the greatest power in the world. Intermix with them a strain of those inflexible French Huguenots who gave up home and fortune, and left their country forever, at the time of the revocation of the Edict of Nantes. The product must obviously be one of the most rugged, virile, unconquerable races ever seen upon earth. Take this formidable people and train them for 7 generations in constant warfare against savage men and ferocious beasts, in circumstances under which no weakling could survive. Place them, so that they acquire exceptional skill with weapons, and in horsemanship. Give them a country which is eminently suited to the tactics of the huntsman, the marksman, and the rider. Then, finally, put a finer temper upon their military qualities, by a dour fatalistic Old Testament religion, and an ardent and consuming patriotism. Combine all these qualities and all these impulses in one individual, and you have the modern Boer, the most formidable antagonist who ever crossed the path of Imperial Britain. Our military history has largely consisted in our conflicts with France, but Napoleon and all his veterans have never treated us so roughly as these hard-bitten farmers with their ancient theology and their inconveniently modern rifles. Look at the map of South Africa, and there, in the very center of the British possessions, like the stone in a peach, lies the great stretch of the two republics, a mighty domain for so small a people. How came they there? Who are these Teutonic folk who have burrowed so deeply into Africa? It is a twice-told tale, and yet it must be told once again if this story is to have even the most superficial of introductions. No one can know or appreciate the Boer who does not know his past, for he is what his past has made him. It was about the time when Oliver Cromwell was at his zenith, in 1652 to be pedantically accurate, that the Dutch made their first lodgment at the Cape of Good Hope. The Portuguese had been there before them, but, repelled by the evil weather, and lured forwards by rumors of gold, they had passed the true seat of empire and had voyaged further to settle along the eastern coast. Some gold there was, but not much, and the Portuguese settlements have never been sources of wealth to the mother country, and never will be until the day when Great Britain signs her huge check for Delagoa Bay. The coast upon which they settled reeked with malaria. 100 miles of poisonous marsh separated it from the healthy inland plateau. For centuries, these pioneers of South African colonization strove to obtain some further footing, but save along the courses of the rivers, they made little progress. Fierce natives and an enervating climate barred their way. But it was different with the Dutch. That very rudeness of climate, which had so impressed the Portuguese adventurer, was the source of their success. Cold and poverty and storm are the nurses of the qualities which make for empire. It is the men from the bleak and barren lands who master the children of the light and the heat. And so the Dutchmen at the Cape prospered and grew stronger in that robust climate. They did not penetrate far inland, for they were few in number, and all they wanted was to be found close at hand. But they built themselves houses, and they supplied the Dutch East India Company with food and water, gradually budding off little townlets, Winburg, Stellenbosch, and pushing their settlements up the long slopes, which lead to that great central plateau which extends for 1,500 miles from the edge of the Karoo to the valley of the Zambesi. Then came the additional Huguenot emigrants, the best blood of France, 300 of them, a handful of the choicest seed thrown in to give a touch of grace and soul to the solid Teutonic strain. Again and again in the course of history, with the Normans, the Huguenots, the emigres, one can see the great hand dipping into that storehouse and sprinkling the nations with the same splendid seed. France has not founded other countries, like her great rival, but she has made every other country the richer by the mixture with her choicest and best. The Roux, Dutoits, Jouberts, Duplessis, Villiers, and a score of other French names are among the most familiar in South Africa. For 100 more years, The history of the colony was a record of the gradual spreading of the Afrikaners over the huge expanse of veldt which lay to the north of them. Cattle raising became an industry, but in a country where 6 acres can hardly support a sheep, large farms are necessary for even small herds. 6,000 acres was the usual size, and £5 a year the rent payable to government. The diseases which follow the white man had in Africa, as in America and Australia, been fatal to the natives, and an epidemic of smallpox cleared the country for the newcomers. Further and further north they pushed, founding little towns here and there such as Graaf-Reinet and Swellendam, where a Dutch Reformed church and a store for the sale of the bare necessaries of life formed a nucleus for a few scattered dwellings. Already, the settlers were showing that independence of control, and that detachment from Europe, which has been their most prominent characteristic. Even the sway of the Dutch Company, an older but weaker brother of John Company in India, had caused them to revolt. The local rising, however, was hardly noticed in the universal cataclysm which followed the French Revolution. After 20 years, during which the world was shaken by the titanic struggle between England and France, in the final counting up of the game and paying of the stakes, the Cape Colony was added in 1814 to the British Empire. In all our vast collection of states, there is probably not one the title deeds to which are more incontestable than to this one. We had it by two rights, the right of conquest and the right of purchase. In 1806 year, our troops landed, defeated the local forces, and took possession of Cape Town. In 1814, we paid the large sum of £6,000,000 to the stadtholder for the transference of this and some South American land. It was a bargain which was probably made rapidly and carelessly in that general redistribution which was going on. As a house of call upon the way to India, the place was seen to be of value, but the country itself was looked upon as unprofitable and desert. What would Castlereagh or Liverpool have thought could they have seen the items which we were buying for our £6,000,000? The inventory would have been a mixed one of good and of evil. 9 fierce Kaffir wars, the greatest diamond mines in the world, the wealthiest gold mines, 2 costly and humiliating campaigns with men whom we respected even when we fought with them, and now at last, we hope, a South Africa of peace and prosperity with equal rights and equal duties for all men. The future should hold something very good for us in that land, for if we merely count the past, we should be compelled to say that we should have been stronger, richer, and higher in the world's esteem, had our possessions there never passed beyond the range of the guns of our men of war. But surely the most arduous is the most honorable, and looking back from the end of their journey, our descendants may see that our long record of struggle, with its mixture of disaster and success, its outpouring of blood and of treasure, has always tended to some great and enduring goal. The title deeds to the estate are, as I have said, good ones, but there is one singular and ominous flaw in their provisions. The ocean has marked 3 boundaries to it, but the 4th is undefined. There is no word of the hinterland, for neither the term nor the idea had then been thought of. Had Great Britain bought those vast regions which extended beyond the settlements? Or were the discontented Dutch at liberty to pass onwards, and found fresh nations to bar the path of the Anglo-Celtic colonists? In that question lay the germ of all the trouble to come. An American would realize the point at issue if he could conceive that after the founding of the United States, the Dutch inhabitants of the state of New York had trekked to the westward and established fresh communities under a new flag. Then, when the American population overtook these western states, they would be face to face with the problem which this country has had to solve. If they found these new states fiercely anti-American and extremely unprogressive, they would experience that aggravation of their difficulties with which our statesmen have had to deal. At the time of their transference to the British flag, the colonists, Dutch, French, and German, numbered some 30,000. They were slaveholders, and the slaves were about as numerous as themselves. The prospect of complete amalgamation between the British and the original settlers would have seemed to be a good one, since they were of much the same stock, and their creeds could only be distinguished by their varying degrees of bigotry and intolerance. 5,000 British emigrants were landed in 1820, settling on the eastern borders of the colony, and from that time onwards there was a slow but steady influx of English-speaking colonists. The government had the historical faults and the historical virtues of British rule. It was mild, clean, honest, tactless, and inconsistent. On the whole, it might have done very well had it been content to leave things as it found them. But to change the habits of the most conservative of Teutonic races was a dangerous venture, and one which has led to a long series of complications, making up the troubled history of South Africa. The imperial government has always taken an honorable and philanthropic view of the rights of the native and the claim which he has to the protection of the law. We hold, and rightly, that British justice, if not blind, should at least be colorblind. The view is irreproachable in theory and incontestable in argument, but it is apt to be irritating when urged by a Boston moralist or a London philanthropist upon men whose whole society has been built upon the assumption that the black is the inferior race. Such a people like to find the higher morality for themselves, not to have it imposed upon them by those who live under entirely different conditions. They feel, and with some reason, that it is a cheap form of virtue which, from the serenity of a well-ordered household in Beacon Street or Belgrave Square, prescribes what the relation shall be between a white employer and his half-savage, half-childish retainers. Both branches of the Anglo-Celtic race have grappled with the question, and in each it has led to trouble. The British government in South Africa has always played the unpopular part of the friend and protector of the native servants. It was upon this very point that the first friction appeared between the old settlers and the new administration. A rising with bloodshed followed the arrest of a Dutch farmer who had maltreated his slave. It was suppressed, and 5 of the participants were hanged. This punishment was unduly severe and exceedingly injudicious. A brave race can forget the victims of the field of battle, but never those of the scaffold. The making of political martyrs is the last insanity of statesmanship. It is true that both the man who arrested and the judge who condemned the prisoners were Dutch, and that the British governor interfered on the side of mercy. But all this was forgotten afterwards in the desire to make racial capital out of the incident. It is typical of the enduring resentment which was left behind that when, after the Jameson raid, it seemed that the leaders of that ill-fated venture might be hanged, the beam was actually brought from a farmhouse at Cookhouse Drift to Pretoria, that the Englishman might die as the Dutchman had died in 1816. Slagter's neck marked the dividing of the ways between the British government and the Afrikaners. And the separation soon became more marked. There were injudicious tamperings with the local government and the local ways, with a substitution of English for Dutch in the law courts. With vicarious generosity, the English government gave very lenient terms to the Kaffir tribes, who in 1834 had raided the border farmers. And then, finally, in this same year, there came the emancipation of the slaves throughout the British Empire, which fanned all smoldering discontents into an active flame. It must be confessed that on this occasion the British philanthropist was willing to pay for what he thought was right. It was a noble national action, and one the morality of which was in advance of its time, that the British Parliament should vote the enormous sum of £20 million to pay compensation to the slaveholders, and so to remove an evil with which the mother country had no immediate connection. It was as well that the thing should have been done when it was, for had we waited till the colonies affected had governments of their own, it could never have been done by constitutional methods. With many a grumble, the good British householder drew his purse from his fob, and he paid for what he thought to be right. If any special grace attends the virtuous action which brings nothing but tribulation in this world, then we may hope for it over this emancipation. We spent our money, we ruined our West Indian colonies, and we started a disaffection in South Africa, the end of which we have not seen. Yet if it were to be done again, we should doubtless do it. The highest morality may prove also to be the highest wisdom when the half-told story comes to be finished. But the details of the measure were less honorable than the principle. It was carried out suddenly, so that the country had no time to adjust itself to the new conditions. £3 million were earmarked for South Africa, which gives a price per slave of from £60 to £70, a sum considerably below the current local rates. Finally, the compensation was made payable in London, so that the farmers sold their claims at reduced prices to middlemen. Indignation meetings were held in every little townlet and cattle camp on the Karoo. The old Dutch spirit was up, the spirit of the men who cut the dikes. Rebellion was useless. But a vast untenanted land stretched to the north of them. The nomad life was congenial to them, and in their huge ox-drawn wagons, like those bullock carts in which some of their old kinsmen came to Gaul, they had vehicles and homes and forts all in one. One by one they were loaded up, the huge teams were inspanned, the women were seated inside, the men with their long-barreled guns walked alongside, and the great exodus was begun. Their herds and flocks accompanied the migration, and the children helped to round them in and drive them. One tattered little boy of 10 cracked his shambok whip behind the bullocks. He was a small item in that singular crowd, but he was of interest to us, for his name was Paul Stephanus Kruger. It was a strange exodus, only comparable in modern times to the sallying forth of the Mormons from Nauvoo upon their search for the promised land of Utah. The country was known and sparsely settled as far north as the Orange River, but beyond there was a great region which had never been penetrated save by some daring hunter or adventurous pioneer. It chanced, if there be indeed such an element as chance in the graver affairs of man, that a Zulu conqueror had swept over this land and left it untenanted, save by the dwarf bushmen, the hideous aborigines, lowest of the human race. There were fine grazing and good soil for the emigrants. They traveled in small detached parties, but their total numbers were considerable, from 6 to 10,000 according to their historian, or nearly a quarter of the whole population of the colony. Some of the early bands perished miserably. A large number made a trysting place at a high peak to the east of Bloemfontein in what was lately the Orange Free State. One party of the emigrants was cut off by the formidable Matabele, a branch of the great Zulu nation. The survivors declared war upon them, and showed in this their first campaign the extraordinary ingenuity in adapting their tactics to their adversary, which has been their greatest military characteristic. The commando which rode out to do battle with the Matabele numbered, it is said, 135 farmers. Their adversaries were 12,000 spearmen. They met at the Maricot River, near Mafeking. The Boers combined the use of their horses and of their rifles so cleverly that they slaughtered a third of their antagonists without any loss to themselves. Their tactics were to gallop up within range of the enemy, to fire a volley, and then to ride away again before the spearmen could reach them. When the savages pursued, the Boers fled. When the pursuit halted, the Boers halted and the rifle fire began anew. The strategy was simple, but most effective. When one remembers how often since then our own horsemen have been pitted against savages in all parts of the world, one deplores that ignorance of all military traditions save our own which is characteristic of our service. This victory of the Voortrekkers cleared all the country between the Orange River and the Limpopo, the sites of what has been known as the Transvaal and the Orange Free State. In the meantime, another body of the emigrants had descended into what is now known as Natal, and had defeated Dingaan, the great chief of the Zulus. Being unable, owing to the presence of their families, to employ the cavalry tactics which had been so effective against the Matabele, they again used their ingenuity to meet this new situation, and received the Zulu warriors in a square of loggered wagons, the men firing while the women loaded. 6 Burghers were killed and 3,000 Zulus. Had such a formation been used 40 years afterwards against these very Zulus, we should not have had to mourn the disaster of Isandlwana. And now, at the end of their great journey, after overcoming the difficulties of distance, of nature, and of savage enemies, the Boers saw at the end of their travels the very thing which they desired least, that which they had come so far to avoid, the flag of Great Britain. The Boers had occupied Natal from within, but England had previously done the same by sea, and a small colony of Englishmen had settled at Port Natal, now known as Durban. The home government, however, had acted in a vacillating way, and it was only the conquest of Natal by the Boers which caused them to claim it as a British colony. At the same time, they asserted the unwelcome doctrine that a British subject could not at will throw off his allegiance, and that, go where they might, the wandering farmers were still only the pioneers of British colonies. To emphasize the fact, three companies of soldiers were sent in 1842 to what is now Durban, the usual corporal's guard with which Great Britain starts a new empire. This handful of men was waylaid by the Boers and cut up, as their successors have been so often since. The survivors, however, fortified themselves and held a defensive position, as also their successors have done so many times since, until reinforcements arrived and the farmers dispersed. It is singular how in history the same factors will always give the same result. Here in this first skirmish is an epitome of all our military relations with these people. The blundering headstrong attack, the defeat, the powerlessness of the farmer against the weakest fortifications, it is the same tale over and over again in different scales of importance. Natal from this time onward became a British colony, and the majority of the Boers trekked north and east with bitter hearts to tell their wrongs to their brethren of the Orange Free State and of the Transvaal. Had they any wrongs to tell? It is difficult to reach that height of philosophic detachment which enables the historian to deal absolutely impartially where his own country is a party to the quarrel. But at least we may allow that there is a case for our adversary. Our annexation of Natal had been by no means definite, and it was they and not we who first broke that bloodthirsty Zulu power which threw its shadow across the country. It was hard, after such trials and such exploits, to turn their back upon the fertile land which they had conquered, and to return to the bare pastures of the upland veldt. They carried out of Natal a heavy sense of injury, which has helped to poison our relations with them ever since. It was, in a way, a momentous episode, this little skirmish of soldiers and emigrants, for it was the heading off of the Boer from the sea and the confinement of his ambition to the land. Had it gone the other way, a new and possibly formidable flag would have been added to the maritime nations. The emigrants who had settled in the huge tract of country between the Orange River in the south and the Limpopo in the north had been recruited by newcomers from the Cape Colony until they numbered some 15,000 souls. This population was scattered over a space as large as Germany and larger than Pennsylvania, New York, and New England. Their form of government was individualistic and democratic to the last degree, compatible with any sort of cohesion. Their wars with the Kaffirs and their fear and dislike of the British government appear to have been the only ties which held them together. They divided and subdivided within their own borders, like a germinating egg. The Transvaal was full of lusty little high-mettled communities, who quarreled among themselves as fiercely as they had done with the authorities at the Cape. Leidenburg, Zoutpansberg, and Potchefstroom were on the point of turning their rifles against each other. In the south, between the Orange River and the Vaal, there was no form of government at all, but a welter of Dutch farmers, Basutos, Hottentots, and half-breeds living in a chronic state of turbulence, recognizing neither the British authority to the south of them nor the Transvaal republics to the north. The chaos became at last unendurable, and in 1848 a garrison was placed in Bloemfontein and the district incorporated in the British Empire. The emigrants made a futile resistance at Boomplatz, and after a single defeat allowed themselves to be drawn into the settled order of civilized rule. At this period, the Transvaal, where most of the Boers had settled, desired a formal acknowledgement of their independence, which the British authorities determined once and for all to give them. The great barren country, which produced little save marksmen, had no attractions for a colonial office which was bent upon the limitation of its liabilities. A convention was concluded between the two parties, known as the Sand River Convention, which is one of the fixed points in South African history. By it, the British government guaranteed to the Boer farmers the right to manage their own affairs and to govern themselves by their own laws without any interference upon the part of the British. It stipulated that there should be no slavery, and with that single reservation washed its hands finally, as it imagined, of the whole question. So the South African Republic came formally into existence. In the very year after the Sand River Convention, a second republic, the Orange Free State, was created by the deliberate withdrawal of Great Britain from the territory which she had for 8 years occupied. The Eastern question was already becoming acute, and the cloud of a great war was drifting up, visible to all men. British statesmen felt that their commitments were very heavy in every part of the world, and the South African annexations had always been a doubtful value and an undoubted trouble. Against the will of a large part of the inhabitants, whether a majority or not, it is impossible to say, we withdrew our troops as amicably as the Romans withdrew from Britain, and the new republic was left with absolute and unfettered independence. On a petition being presented against the withdrawal, the Home Government actually voted £48,000 to compensate those who had suffered from the change. Whatever historical grievance the Transvaal may have against Great Britain, we can at least save, perhaps in one matter, claim to have a very clear conscience concerning our dealings with the Orange Free State. Thus in 1852 and in 1854 were born those sturdy states who were able for a time to hold at bay the united forces of the empire. In the meantime, Cape Colony, in spite of these secessions, had prospered exceedingly, and her population, English, German, and Dutch, had grown by 1870 to over 200,000 souls, the Dutch still slightly predominating. According to the liberal colonial policy of Great Britain, the time had come to cut the cord and let the young nation conduct its own affairs. In 1872 complete, self-government was given to it, the governor, as the representative of the Queen, retaining a nominal unexercised veto upon legislation. According to this system, the Dutch majority of the colony could, and did, put their own representatives into power and run the government upon Dutch lines. Already Dutch law had been restored, and Dutch put on the same footing as English as the official language of the country. The extreme liberality of such measures, and the uncompromising way in which they have been carried out, however distasteful the legislation might seem to English ideas, are among the chief reasons which made the illiberal treatment of British settlers in the Transvaal so keenly resented at the Cape. A Dutch government was ruling the British, in a British colony, at a moment when the Boers would not give an Englishman a vote upon a municipal council in a city which he had built himself. Unfortunately, however, the evil that men do lives after them, and the ignorant Boer farmer continued to imagine that his southern relatives were in bondage, just as the descendant of the Irish emigrant still pictures an Ireland of penal laws and an alien church. For 25 years after the Sand River Convention, the burghers of the South African Republic had pursued a strenuous and violent existence, fighting incessantly with the natives and sometimes with each other, with an occasional fling at the little Dutch Republic to the south. The semi-tropical sun was waking strange ferments in the placid Friesland blood, and producing a race who added the turbulence and restlessness of the south to the formidable tenacity of the north. Strong vitality and violent ambitions produced feuds and rivalries worthy of medieval Italy, and the story of the factious little communities is like a chapter out of Guicciardini. Disorganization ensued. The burghers would not pay taxes, and the treasury was empty. One fierce Kaffir tribe threatened them from the north, and the Zulus on the east. It is an exaggeration of English partisans to pretend that our intervention saved the Boers, for no one can read their military history without seeing that they were a match for Zulus and Sekakuni combined. But certainly a formidable invasion was pending, and the scattered farmhouses were as open to the Kaffirs as our farmers' homesteads were in the American colonies when the Indians were on the warpath. Sir Theophilus Shepstone, the British commissioner, after an inquiry of 3 months, solved all questions by the formal annexation of the country. The fact that he took possession of it with a force of some 25 men showed the honesty of his belief that no armed resistance was to be feared. This then, in 1877, was a complete reversal of the Sand River Convention and the opening of a new chapter in the history of South Africa. There did not appear to be any strong feeling at the time against the annexation. The people were depressed with their troubles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.